Favorite Stories of Christmas Past, narrated by Renee Raudman and Alan Sklar. This unabridged audiobook was produced in the year 2007 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Twas the Night Before Christmas by Clement C. Moore. Twas the night before Christmas, when all through the house not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse. The stockings were hung by the chimney with care, in hopes that St. Nicholas soon would be there. The children were nestled all snug in their beds, while visions of sugar plums danced in their heads, and Mama in her kerchief and I in my cap had just settled our brains for a long winter's nap. When out on the lawn there arose such a clatter, I sprang from the bed to see what was the matter. Away to the window I flew like a flash, tore open the shutters, and threw up the sash. The moon, on the breast of the new-fallen snow, gave the luster of midday to objects below. When what to my wondering eyes should appear but a miniature sleigh and 8 tiny reindeer, with a little old driver so lively and quick, I knew in a moment it must be Saint Nick. More rapid than eagles his coursers they came, and he whistled and shouted and called them by name. Now Dasher, now Dancer, now Prancer and Vixen, on Comet, on Cupid, on Donder and Blitzen, to the top of the porch, to the top of the wall, now dash away, dash away, dash away all. As dry leaves that before the wild hurricane fly, when they meet with an obstacle, mount to the sky, so up to the housetop the coursers they flew, with the sleigh full of toys, and St. Nicholas too. And then, in a twinkling, I heard on the roof the prancing and pawing of each little hoof. As I drew in my head and was turning around, down the chimney St. Nicholas came with a bound. He was dressed all in fur, from his head to his foot, and his clothes were all tarnished with ashes and soot. A bundle of toys he had flung on his back, and he looked like a peddler just opening his pack. His eyes, how they twinkled! His dimples, how merry! His cheeks were like roses, his nose like a cherry. His droll little mouth was drawn up like a bow, and the beard of his chin was as white as the snow. The stump of a pipe he held tight in his teeth, and the smoke it encircled his head like a wreath. He had a broad face and a little round belly that shook when he laughed like a bowl full of jelly. He was chubby and plump, a right jolly old elf, and I laughed when I saw him in spite of myself. A wink of his eye and a twist of his head soon gave me to know I had nothing to dread. He spoke not a word, but went straight to his work, and filled all the stockings, then turned with a jerk, and laying his finger aside of his nose, and giving a nod, up the chimney he rose. He sprang to his sleigh, to his team, gave a whistle, and away they all flew like the down of a thistle. But I heard him exclaim ere he drove out of sight, "Happy Christmas to all, and to all a good night."
The Story of Christmas by Nora A. Smith. Christmas Day, you know, dear children, is Christ's day, Christ's birthday. And I want to tell you why we love it so much, and why we try to make everyone happy when it comes each year. A long, long time ago, more than 1,800 years, the baby Christ was born on Christmas Day. A baby so wonderful and so beautiful, who grew up to be a man so wise, so good, so patient and sweet, that every year the people who know about him love him better and better and are more and more glad when his birthday comes again. You see that he must have been very good and wonderful, for people have always remembered his birthday and kept it lovingly for 1,800 years. He was born long years ago in a land far, far away across the seas. Before the baby Christ was born, Mary, his mother, had to make a long journey with her husband, Joseph. They made this journey to be taxed or counted, for in those days this could not be done in the town where people happened to live, but they must be numbered in the place where they were born. In that far-off time, the only way of traveling was on a horse, or a camel, or a good, patient donkey. Camels and horses cost a great deal of money, and Mary was very poor. So she rode on a quiet, safe donkey while Joseph walked by her side, leading him and leaning on his stick. Mary was very young and beautiful, I think, but Joseph was a great deal older than she. People dress nowadays, in those distant countries, just as they did so many years ago, so we know that Mary must have worn a long, thick dress, falling all about her in heavy folds, and that she had a soft white veil over her head and neck and across her face. Mary lived in Nazareth, and the journey they were making was to Bethlehem, many miles away. They were a long time traveling, I am sure, for donkeys are slow, though they are so careful, and Mary must have been very tired before they came to the end of their journey. They had traveled all day, and it was almost dark when they came near to Bethlehem, to the town where the baby Christ was to be born. There was the place they were to stay, a kind of inn or lodging house, but not at all like those you know about. They have them today in that far-off country, just as they built them so many years ago. It was a low, flat-roofed stone building with no windows and only one large door. There were no nicely furnished bedrooms inside and no soft white beds for the tired travelers. There were only little places built into the stones of the wall, something like the berths on steamboats nowadays, and each traveler brought his own bedding. No pretty garden was in front of the inn, for the road ran close to the very door, so that its dust lay upon the door sill. All around the house, to a high rocky hill at the back, a heavy stone fence was built, so that the people and the animals inside might be kept safe. Mary and Joseph could not get very near the inn, for the whole road in front was filled with camels and donkeys and sheep and cows, while a great many men were going to and fro taking care of the animals. Some of these people had come to Bethlehem to pay their taxes, as Mary and Joseph had done, and others were staying for the night on their way to Jerusalem, a large city a little further on. The yard was filled, too, with camels and sheep, and men were lying on the ground beside them, resting and watching and keeping them safe. The inn was so full, and the yard was so full of people, that there was no room for anybody else. And the keeper had to take Joseph and Mary through the house and back to the high hill, where they found another place that was used for a stable. This had only a door and front, and deep caves were behind, stretching far into the rocks. This was the spot where Christ was born. Think how poor a place! But Mary was glad to be there, after all, and when the Christ child came, he was like other babies, and had so lately come from heaven that he was happy everywhere. There were mangers all around the cave, where the cattle and sheep were fed, and great heaps of hay and straw were lying on the floor. Then, I think, There were brown-eyed cows and oxen there, and quiet woolly sheep, and perhaps even some dogs that had come in to take care of the sheep. And there in the cave, by and by, the wonderful baby came, and they wrapped him up and laid him in a manger. All the stars in the sky shone brightly that night, for they knew the Christ child was born, and the angels in heaven sang together for joy. The angels knew about the lovely child and were glad that he had come to help the people on earth to be good. There lay the beautiful baby, with a manger for his bed, and oxen and sheep all sleeping quietly round him. His mother watched him and loved him, and by and by many people came to see him, for they had heard that a wonderful child was to be born in Bethlehem. All the people in the inn visited him, and even the shepherds left their flocks in the field and sought the child and his mother. But the baby was very tiny and could not talk any more than any other tiny child, so he lay in his mother's lap or in the manger and only looked at the people. So after they had seen him and loved him, they went away again. After a time, when the baby had grown larger, Mary took him back to Nazareth, and there he lived and grew up. And he grew to be such a sweet, wise, loving boy, such a tender, helpful man. And he said so many good and beautiful things that everyone who knew him loved him. Many of the things he said are in the Bible, you know, and a great many beautiful stories of the things he used to do while he was on earth. He loved little children like you very much, and often used to take them up in his arms and talk to them. And this is the reason we love Christmas Day so much, and try to make everybody happy when it comes around each year. This is the reason, because Christ, who was born on Christmas Day, has helped us all to be good so many, many times, and because he was the best Christmas present the world ever had. A Country Christmas by Louisa May Alcott. Dear Emily, I have a brilliant idea, and at once hastened to share it with you. 3 weeks ago, I came up here to the wilds of Vermont to visit my old aunt, also to get a little quiet and distance in which to survey certain new prospects which have opened before me, and to decide whether I will marry a millionaire and become a queen of society, or remain the charming Miss Vaughan and wait till the conquering hero comes. Aunt Plumie begs me to stay over Christmas, and I have consented, as I always dread the formal dinner with which my guardian celebrates the day. My brilliant idea is this. I'm going to make it a real old-fashioned frolic, and won't you come and help me? You will enjoy it immensely, I am sure, for Aunt is a character. Cousin Saul worth seeing, and Ruth a far prettier girl than any of the city rosebuds coming out this season. Bring Leonard Randall along with you to take notes for his new books. Then it will be fresher and truer than the last, clever as it was. The air is delicious up here, society amusing, this old farmhouse full of treasures, and your bosom friend pining to embrace you. Just telegraph yes or no, and we will expect you on Tuesday. Ever yours, Sophie Vaughan. They will both come, for they are as tired of city life and as fond of change as I am, said the writer of the above, as she folded her letter and went to get it posted without delay. Aunt Plumie was in the great kitchen making pies, a jolly old soul with a face as ruddy as a winter apple, a cheery voice, and the kindest heart that ever beat under a gingham gown. Pretty Ruth was chopping the mince and singing so gaily as she worked that the 24 immortal blackbirds could not have put more music into a pie than she did. Saul was piling wood into the big oven, and Sophie paused a moment on the threshold to look at him, for she always enjoyed the sight of this stalwart cousin, whom she likened to a Norse Viking, with his fair hair and beard, keen blue eyes, and 6 feet of manly height, with shoulders that looked broad and strong enough to bear any burden. His back was toward her, but he saw her first, and turned his flushed face to meet her with the sudden lighting up it always showed when she approached. "I've done it, Aunt, and now I want Saul to post the letter, so we can get a speedy answer."
"Just as soon as I can hitch up, cousin."
And Saul pitched in his last log, looking ready to put a girdle round the earth in less than 40 minutes.
"Well, dear, I ain't the least mite of objection, as long as it pleases you. I guess we can stand it if your city folks can. I presume to say things would look kind of singular to 'em, but I suppose that's what they come for, hm? Idle folks do dreadful queer things to amuse 'em."
And Aunt Plumie leaned on the rolling pin to smile and nod with a shrewd twinkle of her eye, as if she enjoyed the prospect as much as Sophie did.
"I shall be afraid of 'em, but I'll try not to make you ashamed of me," said Ruth, who loved her charming cousin even more than she admired her.
"No fear of that, dear. They will be the awkward ones, and you must set them at ease by just being your simple selves and treating them as if they were everyday people. Nell is very nice and jolly when she drops her city ways, as she must here. She will enter into the spirit of fun at once, and I know you'll all like her. Mr. Randall is rather the worse for too much praise and petting, as successful people are apt to be, so a little plain talk and rough work will do him good. He is a true gentleman, in spite of his airs and elegance, and he will take it all in good part if you treat him like a man and not a lion."
"I'll see to him,"
said Saul, who had listened with great interest to the latter part of Sophie's speech, evidently suspecting a lover, and enjoying the idea of supplying him with a liberal amount of plain talk and rough work.
"I'll keep 'em busy if that's what they need, for there will be a sight to do. And we can't get help easy up here. Our daughters don't hire out much, work to home till they marry, and don't go gadding round getting their heads full of foolish notions and forgetting all the useful things their mothers taught 'em."
Aunt Plumie glanced at Ruth as she spoke, and a sudden color in the girl's cheeks proved that the words hit certain ambitious fancies of this pretty daughter of the House of Bassett.
"They shall do their parts and not be a trouble. I'll see to that, for you certainly are the dearest aunt in the world to let me take possession of you and yours in this way," cried Sophie, embracing the old lady with warmth.
Saul wished the embrace could be returned by proxy, as his mother's hands were too floury to do more than hover affectionately round the delicate face that looked so fresh and young beside her wrinkled one. As it could not be done, he fled temptation and hitched up without delay. The three women laid their heads together in his absence, and Sophie's plan grew apace, for Ruth longed to see a real novelist and a fine lady, and Aunt Plumie, having plans of her own to further, said, "Yes, dear," to every suggestion. Great was the arranging and adorning that went on that day in the old farmhouse, for Sophie wanted her friends to enjoy this taste of country pleasures, and knew just what additions would be indispensable to their comfort, what simple ornaments would be in keeping with the rustic stage on which she meant to play the part of prima donna. Next day, a telegram arrived accepting the invitation for both the lady and the lion. They would arrive that afternoon, as little preparation was needed for this impromptu journey, the novelty of which was its chief charm to these blasé people. Saul wanted to get out the double sleigh and span, for he prided himself on his horses, and a fall of snow came most opportunely to beautify the landscape and add a new pleasure to Christmas festivities.
but Sophie declared that the old yellow sleigh with Punch, the farm horse, must be used, as she wished everything to be in keeping. And Saul obeyed, thinking he had never seen anything prettier than his cousin when she appeared in his mother's old-fashioned camlet cloak and blue silk pumpkin hood. He looked remarkably well himself in his fur coat, with his hair and beard brushed till they shone like spun gold, a fresh color in his cheek, and the sparkle of amusement in his eyes, while excitement gave his usually grave face the animation it needed to be handsome. Away they jogged in the creaking old sleigh, leaving Ruth to make herself pretty with a fluttering heart, and Aunt Plumy to dish up a late dinner fit to tempt the most fastidious appetite. "She has not come for us, and there is not even a stage to take us up. There must be some mistake," said Emily Herrick, as she looked about the shabby little station where they were set down.
"That is the never-to-be-forgotten face of our fair friend, but the bonnet of her grandmother, if my eyes do not deceive me," answered Randall, turning to survey the couple approaching in the rear.
"Sophie Vaughan, what do you mean by making such a guy of yourself?" exclaimed Emily as she kissed the smiling face in the hood and stared at the quaint cloak. "I'm dressed for my part, and I intend to keep it up. This is our host, my cousin, Saul Bassett. Come to the sleigh at once. He will see to your luggage," said Sophie, painfully conscious of the antiquity of her array as her eyes rested on Emily's pretty hat and mantle and the masculine elegance of Randall's wraps. They were hardly tucked in when Saul appeared with a valise in one hand and a large trunk on his shoulder, swinging both onto a wood sled that stood nearby as easily as if they had been handbags. "That is your hero, is it? Well, he looks it, calm and comely, taciturn and tall," said Emily in a tone of approbation.
"He should have been named Samson or Goliath, though I believe it was the small man who slung things about and turned out the hero in the end," added Randall, surveying the performance with interest and a touch of envy, for much pen work had made his own hands as delicate as a woman's.
"Saul doesn't live in a glass house, so stones won't hurt him. Remember, sarcasm is forbidden and sincerity the order of the day. You are country folks now, and it will do you good to try their simple, honest ways for a few days." Sophie had no time to say more, for Saul came up and drove off with the brief remark that the baggage would
be along right away.
Being hungry, cold, and tired, the guests were rather silent during the short drive, but Aunt Plumy's hospitable welcome and the savory fumes from the dinner awaiting them thawed the ice and won their hearts at once. "Isn't it nice? Aren't you glad you came?" asked Sophie, as she led her friends into the parlor, which she had redeemed from its primness by putting bright chintz curtains to the windows, hemlock boughs over the old portraits, a china bowl of flowers on the table, and a splendid fire on the wide hearth. "It is perfectly jolly, and this is the way I begin to enjoy myself," answered Emily, sitting down upon the homemade rug, whose red flannel roses bloomed in a blue list basket.
"If I may add a little smoke to your glorious fire, it will be quite perfect. Won't Samson join me?" asked Randall, waiting for permission, cigar case in hand.
"He has no small vices, but you may indulge yours," answered Sophie from the depths of a grandmotherly chair. Emily glanced up at her friend as if she caught a new tone in her voice, then turned to the fire again with a wise little nod, as if confiding some secret to the reflection of herself in the bright brass andiron.
"His Delilah does not take this form. I wait with interest to discover if he has one. What a daisy the sister is. Does she ever speak?"
asked Randall, trying to lounge on the haircloth sofa where he was slipping uncomfortably about. "Oh, yes, and sings like a bird. You shall hear her when she gets over her shyness. But no trifling, mind you, for it is a jealously guarded daisy and not to be picked by any idle hand," said Sophie warningly,
as she recalled Ruth's blushes and Randall's compliments at dinner.
I should expect to be annihilated by the big brother if I attempted any but the sincerest admiration and respect. Have no fears on that score, but tell us what is to follow this superb dinner. An Appleby, spinning match, husking party, or primitive pastime of some sort, I have no doubt.
As you are new to our ways, I am going to let you rest this evening. We will sit about the fire and tell stories. Aunt is a master hand at that, and Saul has reminiscences of the war that are well worth hearing, if we can only get him to tell them.
Ah, he was there, was he?
Yes, all through it, and is Major Bassett, though he likes his plain name best. He fought splendidly and had several wounds, though only a mere boy when he earned his scars and bars. I'm very proud of him for that. And Sophie looked so as she glanced at the photograph of a stripling in uniform set in the place of honor on the high mantelpiece.
We must stir him up and hear these martial memories. I want some new incidents, and shall book all I can get, if I may.
Here, Randall was interrupted by Saul himself, who came in with an armful of wood for the fire.
Anything more I can do for you, cousin?
He asked, surveying the scene with a rather wistful look. Only come and sit with us and talk over war times with Mr. Randall.
When I've fodded the cattle and done my chores, I'd be pleased to. What regiment were you in?
Asked Saul, looking down from his lofty height upon the slender gentleman, who answered briefly,
In none. I was abroad at the time.
Sick?
No, busy with the novel.
Took 4 years to write it?
I was obliged to travel and study before I could finish it. These things take more time to work up than outsiders would believe.
Seems to me our war was a finer story than any you could find in Europe, and the best way to study it would be to fight it out. If you want heroes and heroines, you'd have found plenty of them there.
I have no doubt of it, and shall be glad to atone for my seeming neglect of them by hearing about your own exploits, Major.
Randall hoped to turn the conversation gracefully, but Saul was not to be caught, and left the room, saying with a gleam of fun in his eye,
I can't stop now. Heroes can wait. Pigs can't.
The girls laughed at this sudden descent from the sublime to the ridiculous, and Randall joined them, feeling his condescension had not been unobserved. As if drawn by the merry sound, Aunt Plumy appeared, and being established in the rocking chair, fell to talking as easily as if she had known her guests for years.
Laugh away, young folks. That's better for digestion than any of the messes people use. Are you troubled with dyspepsy, dear? You didn't seem to take your victuals very hearty, so I mistrusted you as delicate,
she said, looking at Emily, whose pale cheeks and weary eyes told the story of late hours and a gay life. I haven't eaten so much for years, I assure you, Mrs. Bassett, but it was impossible to taste all your good things. I am not dyspeptic, thank you, but a little seedy and tired, for I've been working rather hard lately.
Be you a teacher, or have you a professin', as they call a trade nowadays?
Asked the old lady in a tone of kindly interest, which prevented a laugh at the idea of Emily's being anything but a beauty and a belle. The others kept their countenances with difficulty, and she answered demurely,
I have no trade as yet, but I dare say I should be happier if I had.
Not a doubt, my dear.
What would you recommend, ma'am?
I should say dressmaking was rather in your line, ain't it? Your clothes is dreadful tasty, and do you credit if you made 'em yourself.
And Aunt Plumy surveyed with feminine interest the simple elegance of the traveling dress which was the masterpiece of a French modiste.
No, ma'am, I don't make my own things. I'm too lazy. It takes so much time and trouble to select them that I only have strength left to wear them.
Housekeeping used to be the favorite profession in my day. It ain't fashionable now, but it needs a sight of training to be perfect in all that's required. and I've an idea, it would be...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.